We invite you to rise now for the posting of the colors. Thank you. Please be seated. We welcome you to our service today, where we grieve the loss and honor the memories of Paul Elmstrand, Matt Ruge, and Adam Finseth. The families are grateful for your presence here today. Those of you who are here in person, those of you who are in rooms all around this great facility, those of you who are over at Prince of Peace in Burnsville, and wherever else you may be watching from, they're grateful to have you paying attention to them today. Let's pray together. Our Lord, we ask you to be with us today as we honor these three heroes, those who risked their lives and gave their lives to seek to protect others. As we listen to the stories and reflect on their lives, we ask you to both comfort us and also inspire us as we move forward. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. At this time, I'll invite Burnsville Mayor Elizabeth Coutts to come share her thoughts with us today.
The cords of death entangled us. The anguish of the grave came over us. We were overcome with distress and sorrow. Then we called on the name of God. God is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. God protects the unwary, for God has been good to us. Welcome. I am Elizabeth Couts, mayor of the city of Burnsville. Today's public safety memorial service honors the lives of our dedicated heroes. Burnsville officers, police officers, Paul Elmstrand and Matthew Ruge, and Burnsville firefighter paramedic Adam Finseth. Today, I look over the thousands of people who have gathered here to honor our fallen heroes, our brothers, their families, and our community. I think of the thousands more who are watching online. I think of the hundreds of thousands from across the world who have reached out to us to show us how much they cared about Paul, Matthew, and Adam. Along with everyone standing beside us, I offer my sincere gratitude to our governor, our federal, state, and local elected officials who are here, and to those who couldn't join us today. We're grateful for the unwavering support we've received from all of you and our community through this extraordinary loss. Your presence, caring actions, and kind words continue to give us strength and hope for the days ahead. I offer my condolences on behalf of our city council, our city manager, and the entire staff of the city of Burnsville to the families and friends of our fallen heroes. Now, let's pay tribute and celebrate the lives of Adam, Paul, and Matthew.
Chaplain has received a call around 6 o'clock that Sunday morning. One of the first people I met when I arrived around 7 o'clock down at HCMC was Adam Medlicott. We're going to ask Sergeant Medlicott to come now and share his unique perspective and share some words with us today.
Hello, I am Sergeant Adam Medlicott of the Burnsville Police Department. I want to thank you all for attending today to honor and remember our fallen heroes. I would like to talk briefly and share a few stories about my partners and friends, Paul Elmstrand and Matthew Ruge. I supervised both of them on nights and was standing with them on their final call. I was one of Paul's field training officers. Although I quickly realized how smart and thoughtful Paul was, he still had his moments. One day, we were dispatched to a report of a theft in progress at Macy's. As we pulled up to the store, we saw a vehicle unoccupied and idling in front of the main entrance. Excitedly, Paul yells, "Look, it's the go-away vehicle." I kind of just looked at him in disbelief for a moment before saying, "It's getaway car, Paul." It seemed like that story would come up every couple weeks and we would have a good laugh again. Paul was not a shy person. Many times he would bust into my office uninvited, sit down and make himself at home just to talk or pick my brain on something. Recently, he had been talking to me about the open sergeant position he was considering putting in. He was asking questions about the testing process and what it was like to be a sergeant. "Chief, I think Paul would have made an excellent sergeant." "I'll miss our midnight talks, Paul." I remember the very first call I went on with Matthew Ruge. I was training a new officer, and Matt had just completed field training himself. We were dispatched to a young lady who was to start an addiction treatment program that day. A van was outside of her house to bring her to the facility, but she had sat down inside a closet and was refusing to leave. I watched Matt and the new officer that I was training work through this call for a while, and it was a disaster. They didn't know what to say or how to say it. And I remember Matt looking back at me with a face that said, "I don't know what else to do." That's when I had to step in, and I took over all the talking. A little while later, I had talked this young lady out of the house and into the van for treatment. After the call, Matt walked up to me and said, "Thanks, Adam. Man, I really effed that one up." He used the real word, though. Like any other cop, I said back to him, "Yeah, you really did." But I also told him that he was young and he was new to the profession. I'd been doing this for over a decade. "You'll learn, you'll grow, you'll get a lot better." I was standing next to him on his last call, but now it was Matt that was doing all the talking. And now it was me that was looking to him for the answer. I believed in him as a crisis negotiator, and everyone here should know he was doing an amazing job of it. You can't reason with evil. You didn't F this one up, Matt. I was fortunate enough to watch both of these officers go full circle. From two wide-eyed, excited new cops, one who didn't know it was called a getaway car, and another who didn't know how to talk to someone in crisis, to an officer who knew the job so well he was ready to promote, and another who had just taken over a scene for multiple hours as a crisis negotiator. Finseth, I didn't know you as well as the other two, so unfortunately I don't have any intimate stories to share with you. But I saw you run into the line of fire to save me and my guys. You're the bravest person I've ever known. I will be forever thankful. Elmstrand, Ruge, Finseth, we were there for 7 children. Nothing could be more honorable. Rest easy, brothers.
Now we have 3 colleagues who will come and share some of their memories as they honor their close friends that they worked with. Officer Miller, Deputy Chief Smith, and Captain Johansson. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Pete Mueller. We get to talk about Matt. Matt Ruge and I began our careers with the Burnsville Police Department in April 2020. We were sworn in together and we became pals. Badge number 183 was pinned on Matt's chest, and I received badge 184, which made him my senior officer. And on occasion, he would sheepishly remind me of this. And then he'd needle me a little bit more by pointing out that I was very senior to him in age. He and I started at a unique time, which coincided with a pandemic and unrest. And Ruge rose up to these challenges, and he reaffirmed his commitment to service. His sense of humor and unwavering desire to make a difference immediately earned my respect. Matt and I worked together on our 11th shift in 2021, and we took as many calls for service as possible. He wanted to keep his day shift partner's plates clear while getting as many repetitions as he could. Hearing the nickname Rogie, because he would often go rogue by self-assigning calls outside of his designated area. He gained some significant experience early on due to his relentless work ethic and being involved in several critical incidents as well. In 2022, Matt sought a new challenge when he bid the night shift. He made dear friends. He learned from them, he backed them, trained with them, hung out with them, gamed with them. Ruge successfully handled difficult calls and developed tremendous confidence as an officer that year. His partners, sergeants, investigators found him to be extremely reliable and consistent. And Ruge earned another nickname, the Book. And that's because he went by the book in every situation. I rejoined Matt as his day-for-day dog watch partner in 2023. In addition, he and I became members of the department's crisis negotiation team, and we attended a 40-hour FBI course together in the fall. And he was a perfect fit for this role. And it was because of his calm demeanor and his authenticity. And my admiration and affection for Matt grew as we worked together and learned together. I think the entire department would attest that it was impossible not to love Ruge. He was smart, self-deprecating, quick-witted, humble, and last year I watched Matt become a trustworthy resource for his partners, both old and new. This year, I chose a schedule that would allow me to work day for day with him again, and I was excited to hang out with him. I was excited to listen to our partners tease him about his dating life. I was excited to hear Ruge tell stories about the time that he spent with his family and friends during trips up to Champlin or out to Arizona or down to his old stopping grounds in Wabasha and Mankato. I also looked forward to responding to difficult calls with him, working as a team, deploying crisis negotiation techniques side by side, and we received that opportunity on Sunday morning, February 18th. And those touched by Matt in his passing must know, as Sergeant Medlicott mentioned, he was extraordinarily heroic that morning. He negotiated for several hours, which bought us time. And in law enforcement, we know that time is our friend. And the time that he delivered brought countless resources to the scene, which protected many of us. Furthermore, when the unthinkable happened, Matt brought his partner Paul to safety, although he was hurt himself. And Ruge repeatedly risked his life to save our friend, and in doing so, Matt made the ultimate sacrifice. And it is unacceptable that Matt did not go home that morning. The loss that his family and friends feel is unbearable. And at the same time, it is also true that Ruge left us with remarkable gifts. For example, I noticed that I'm saying I love you a lot this last week and a half, and I'm hearing I love you a lot too. And we're greeting each other with hugs. And I've noticed the outpouring of support for police officers and first responders and our families in a way that I've never seen before. And we're all in awe and so appreciative of the empathy and encouragement. I've also noticed that I'm praying a lot more with gratitude and for healing. And Matt also left us the gift of his example. Many of the things which I've already mentioned, his authenticity, his work ethic, his playfulness, his sense of humor, his selflessness, his trustworthiness, integrity, and commitment to service. And all these gifts that he's given us are good things. And we'd be better off if the things that we're doing now continue. And if they do, and we follow Matt's example, then we become better people for it. And if we become better people for it, then I think that makes Ruge an even bigger hero than he already is. So Matt, Ruge, Ruge, Rogi, the book, my senior officer, 45183, thank you for these gifts. Thank you for your friendship. Thank you for having our backs. We love you and we'll miss you so much.
Hello, my name is Matt Smith. I have the privilege to work with the Burnsville Police Department. It's cliche sometimes in a time of tragedy to say that these were the nicest people. But in this case, it's true. These three men really were the nicest people. That's why I'm honored, was honored when Paul's close friends asked if I would say a few words about him. I found it comforting over the last week to find that many of the things I would say about Paul have also been said by his family and closest friends. This tells me that these aren't just words, but truly embody who Paul was. First of these attributes was Paul's laugh. Paul had a laugh that was infectious. And it's been said that perhaps Paul's favorite comedian to induce this laugh was Paul. Paul also was an avid watcher, and we have learned, re-watcher, of the television show The Office. Last week when we met with Cindy, she asked if she could grab a few things from his desk. True to Paul, there were a number of The Office references in his cabinet. There was also what appeared to be an empty milk bottle with some handwritten notes on the side. Cindy looked up at Chief and I as if to say, "What's this about?" With all of the confidence I could muster, I looked back at Cindy and said, "No idea." But I know that whatever that bottle was about meant something to Paul and his friends. And now it means something to Cindy. And I can only imagine that whatever was behind that inside joke involved Paul and his laugh. Another recurring theme this week has been Paul's dedication to honoring fallen officers. For those who don't know, LEMA, or the Law Enforcement Memorial Association, is the group that helps put on services like this one here today. The Honor Guard is part of this team and helps bestow the honors at these services. Recently, Paul applied for a spot on the LEMA Honor Guard. I happened to run into Paul as he was coming back from one of the parts of the selection process. He was so excited and proud to apply to be a part of the LEMA Honor Guard. I'm told that he would often polish his boots or practice formations and movements in the family living room. Paul was notified just a few weeks ago that he had made the LEMA Honor Guard team, where he would have been honored, would have honored the fallen as we are doing today. I was also reminded this week that Paul's commitment to honoring our heroes is not new to him. On September 14th, 2017, Paul was a community service officer with our department. On that day, Paul joined the Burnsville contingent to attend the funeral of Wyzetta Officer Matthews. Paul had been with us for only 1 month and 1 week at the time. Perhaps the theme that has come up most this week is Paul's love for his family. He absolutely adored Cindy, Maria, and Mateo. I was fortunate to see this firsthand last year on Peace Officer Memorial Day. Paul was at the Capitol representing the Burnsville Honor Guard. Cindy and Maria were there, and there became an impromptu photo session. I got to watch as the Elmstrand family cuddled in for the various poses. Later that night, Paul sent me one of those pictures of him holding Maria. A minute later came another one with a note that said, "All right, just one more. She's too cute, huh?" In that day, I was able to see the extent of Paul's pride for honoring the fallen and love for his family. Paul truly was one of the nicest guys. We're going to miss him.
My name is Brandon Johansson, and I'm a captain with the Burnsville Fire Department. I had the pleasure of working alongside Adam as his captain for the past 3.5 years. I know that may not seem like a long time, but if you knew Adam, he can make a huge impact in a short amount of time. It is my honor to sum up his significant impact in just a few minutes. Adam was a husband, a father, a son, a brother, a friend, and more. He was also a soldier, a firefighter, and a paramedic. Adam was one of the most selfless individuals I have ever had the privilege of knowing. He possessed an innate ability to put others' well-being before his own, always ensuring that everyone around him felt seen, heard, and cared for. His compassion knew no bounds, and his unwavering commitment to the happiness and comfort of those he cared for and loved was truly extraordinary. Opening up to Adam was like stepping into a sanctuary of trust, empathy, and understanding. He had an unparalleled knack for sensing when something wasn't quite right. He was always there to lend a listening ear, offer words of wisdom, or to simply share a laugh. His genuine concern for the welfare of others often led to heartfelt conversations and lengthy discussions as Adam poured his heart and soul into easing the burdens of those around him. His kindness, compassion, and generosity knew no bounds, and his presence enriched the lives of everyone he touched. Adam was a man of honor, integrity, and kindness. His actions spoke louder than his words. You never heard him speak ill will of anyone. In a world where cynicism and self-interest often prevail, Adam stood as a testament to the power of goodness and true selflessness. He reminded us all that strength is found not in force or aggression, but in the quiet courage to stand up for what is right, even when difficult. At the firehouse, Adam was a jokester. His infectious laugh and witty banter brought joy to even the toughest days. We could always count on him to lighten the mood with his quick wit and playful demeanor. That signature smirk that preceded his clever remarks will forever be etched in our memories. Adam was more than a comedian. He was deeply committed to his role as a firefighter and paramedic. He was always taking on new roles and responsibilities while also taking the time to teach others. He also possessed an innate, insatiable curiosity and genuine desire to know everything happening, not out of nosiness, but out of a sincere dedication to doing what was right for his patients and the department. Not only was Adam dedicated to the job, but most importantly, he was dedicated to his family. To you, Tara, I am honored and humbled to have spent these last days with you and your family. I am deeply sorry for your loss. Please know that Adam's bravery, courage, and sacrifice will never be forgotten. As you can see behind you, you're surrounded by our family, which is also your family. A family that will be at your side through all that is to come, now and forever. We will offer unwavering support and love in moments of uncertainty and fear. You don't have to walk this journey alone. We love you, and we will be here for you every step of the way. Liam, Nora, I need to tell you that your papa is a hero. He loves you very much. He talked about you every day at work when he was not with you. It's okay to feel sad and miss him. We can talk about him and remember the good times whenever you want. Remember that even though he's not here with us today, he will always be with you and live in our hearts forever. Adam, I know you're up there in heaven probably looking down and thinking, this is all too much. Well, brother, you deserve it. You are the best of us. We love you. We miss you. We promise to take care of the family and each other. Your legacy and impact will live on forever.
Last, now that Police Chief Tanya Schwartz and Fire Chief B.J. Youngerman come and share their perspective and their words.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Tanya Schwartz, and I'm the Burnsville Police Chief. I stand before you today with a heavy heart and a range of emotions as we honor these fallen heroes. I offer my deepest condolences to the Ruge, Elmstrand, and Finseth families. To lose a brother, a husband, a father, a son, a grandson, is devastating, and my heart breaks for all of you. The Burnsville Police Department and the entire public safety community share in the loss of our beloved brothers. I'd be remiss if I didn't acknowledge the grief that Chief Jungman and our Burnsville Fire Department partners are going through. We may wear different uniforms, but together we will get through the difficult days ahead. The support we've received from our brothers and sisters in blue, brown, maroon, and every other color that I see in this space has been absolutely unbelievable. It was heartwarming to see hundreds of law enforcement officials, firefighters, EMS, standing at attention when we left the hospital on that terrible morning just over a week ago. Before we walked out those doors into a sea of your support, the staff at Hennepin County Medical Center cared for us in the earliest and most shocking hours of our grief. To our public safety community, you have embraced us. You have dropped off gifts. You have stood guard at the hospital. You have kept our community safe while we have been grieving and trying to make sense of this tragedy. And we know that you are grieving too. You have given us strength when we have needed it the most. We will never forget what you have done. Thank you for having our six. We will always have yours. The world of law enforcement is unique. It takes a strong, resilient, selfless person to choose this profession. I think most in this room would agree it's not a job. It's a calling to serve, and we do it because it's an honor. We do it to help others, to protect the most vulnerable, and to make our communities safer. We do it to make a difference, just as Matt and Paul did. Unfortunately, pinning on our badge means sacrifice. Sacrifice for the officers, sacrifice for the families. Over the past week, we have seen the worst and the best of what the law enforcement calling brings. The absolute worst began on February 18th with the loss of these heroes. As I struggled to make sense of what happened that morning, I was reminded that Paul, Matt, and Adam were doing what they were called to do, which was protecting those in harm's way. They give up their lives to protect others and to protect each other. And I ask that you just reflect on that for a moment. These brave men took an oath to keep the community safe. And that's exactly what they did that morning they died. I will be forever grateful for their sacrifice. As most of you know, we place a mourning band across our badges following the death of one of our fallen public safety heroes. In Burnsville, our band depicts the thin blue line. The thin blue line and the red line that our fire and paramedic partners honor does not represent division, but rather solidarity, selflessness, courage, bravery, and the ultimate sacrifice. As I look around this room, I cannot help but think about the sense of solidarity that surrounds us as we grieve and honor our fallen together. When we lose a brother or a sister in this tragic way, we are often asked, why would we continue to do this? Why would we continue to show up each day? And those in uniform simply say, because it's right, because it's needed, because it's who we are. So thank you for putting your uniform on in the most challenging and dangerous times in law enforcement, and doing it every day since our brothers were killed in the line of duty. I'm honored to serve with all of you, and I know our fallen were honored as well. For those who struggle, and there will be struggle, we will get through this together. We will take care of each other. Be strong, be courageous, and remember, our communities need us. On July 21st, 2019, Officer Paul Elmstrand, and on April 13th, 2020, Officer Matt Ruge took an oath to serve the Burnsville community. Their careers were off to a bright start, and both were proudly wearing the Burnsville badge. They knew it represented authority, but more than that, they knew it represented service and sacrifice. They knew it represented a trusted relationship with our community. Matt brought a smile and a positive attitude to his work every day. He was one of the department's hostage negotiators, a role he served in due to his calm demeanor, his great tone, and his empathy. He was passionate about helping people suffering in crisis, always humble and willing to go above and beyond the call of duty. Matt served with compassion to protect the vulnerable. Paul was part of the department's honor guard, which truly became a passion for him. As you heard, so much so, he applied for the State Law Enforcement Memorial Association Honor Guard. And he was recently selected. He wanted to provide unwavering support to families, all the families of the fallen. The irony of that is not lost on me. Matt and Paul loved being police officers. They did the job selflessly, with integrity, honor, and courage. They knew the dangers, but it never deterred them. On February 18th, they paid the ultimate sacrifice while trying to protect children. Their bravery and willingness to put themselves before others is why the word hero is now synonymous with each of their names. To those who wear the title of family member, thank you will never be enough. You share in the criticism, emotion, and burden tied to the profession. You are the backbone that keeps us going through the hard hours, long shifts, and horrific calls. And this past week, you shared in our worst nightmare when members of our public safety family were killed in the line of duty. We know your grief is immense. Thank you for your support and your sacrifice. To the Ruge, Elmstrand, and Finseth families, your lives are forever changed, and our departments will not be the same without these fallen heroes. Please accept my heartfelt thank you for sharing your loved ones with the Burnsville community. We are all better for knowing them. Matt and Paul chose this career to keep people in our city safe, and they gave their lives doing just that. It feels cruel. There are no words to provide sufficient comfort. All we can do is promise you our support, and we assure you that we will forever be by your side. I cannot imagine the hole their deaths have left in your lives. Navigating a new normal without their hugs, their smiles, their kindness, and all of the things you love dearly about them. It will be difficult and it will take time. Know that you have our unwavering commitment to continue to walk alongside of you. To our fallen heroes, thank you. We miss you. Know that we will continue to wear the badge with honor and serve with courage, just as you did. Know that this will not break us, and we will find peace because that is what you would want us to do. Know that we will never give up because you didn't. Know that we will lay our burdens and our guilt down because that is what you would want us to do. Know that you will forever be missed, but we will always be united. Know that you can rest easy, and we've got it from here.
Good morning, everyone. I am BJ Jungman, the fire chief for the city of Burnsville. I'm honored to spend a few minutes talking about firefighter paramedic Adam Finseth. We are fortunate to have Adam Finseth as a firefighter paramedic on our team for the past 5 years. As the fire chief, it's my responsibility to ensure we hire the highest quality people with impeccable character traits to serve the community. In our department, we do this by using our four cultural values to guide who we hire, what we expect, and how we act. Our four cultural values are character, communication, collaboration, and competence. Adam was exemplary of these four cultural values. I only have time to talk about one of these today, so I chose to focus on the character value. We describe this value through three words: dedication, honor, and integrity. Adam displayed extreme dedication to the department. Adam was always working to improve himself. Being a firefighter paramedic was not enough for him. He took on additional roles. Adam was a very active member of our health and wellness committee, which focused on taking care of our firefighters so they can better care for themselves, both physically and mentally. Adam was also a tactical paramedic on the SWAT team, which was about taking care of others who put themselves in extreme danger to protect our community. Adam was also a water rescue instructor ensuring all of our staff are prepared to rescue those that find themselves falling through the ice or drowning in a body of water. He was a truly dedicated member of the Burnsville Fire Department. Adam was the epitome of honor. The profession itself is honorable. Adam had a propensity to seek out these honorable professions, and he sought them out not for the glory, but because he wanted to serve honorably. Adam started his career by serving our country in the Army. Then Adam continued by serving his local community as a firefighter and a paramedic. Adam had a servant's heart and was the most humble person you could meet. Without exception, the first question out of Adam's mouth when you would see him was, "How's the family?" These examples don't speak of a man seeking glory. These are examples of an honorable man serving honorably. Adam displayed the highest degree of integrity. I've been able to get to know some of Adam's family over the past week. Not surprisingly, I found that Adam was the same at home as he was on the job. Adam's consistency of character is the definition of integrity. There were no surprises. He treated everyone in the community as he would want to treat his own family. We know someone's true character and how they will, we don't know someone's character and how they will respond until they are tested. As I observed, and I worked alongside Adam in his career as a firefighter paramedic, and what we all know about the actions during his final moments of his life, I can say without reservation, firefighter paramedic Adam Finseth was tried, he was tested, and he was found worthy. Adam died helping his comrades without a second thought. I'm going to miss him greatly. It's been a tough week, but I can say the level of character I've seen and experienced, not only of Adam, but everyone who continues to serve, makes me proud. I would challenge everyone who is attending this memorial service to honor Adam daily by emulating how he had consistently acted. Just take one thing Adam did and emulate it consistently. If everyone did the things Adam did, the world would be a kinder and more loving place. To Adam, Paul, and Matt's families, I want you to know your public safety family is with you now and into the future. Today we pay tribute and give honor. Tomorrow we will get back to the honorable work of serving others. My brothers and sisters who serve, take care of each other and take care of yourselves. I'd like to close with this quote. The truest heroes don't choose to die. They choose to live a life where facing death is a possibility, driven by the love that compels them to protect others. It's been a privilege to serve with you, Adam. God bless you, and we will miss you.
I got ahead of myself earlier and I didn't allow time for the music video. I'm going to ask our scripture readers to come now, but if the tech people would play the video right after that, we appreciate it. So we have one reader from chosen by each family to read one scripture reading chosen by each family. So I'll ask the three of you to come forward now.
On behalf of the Ruge and Hanke family, we thank you so very much for coming out, for your support and your love. It's beyond words of what you guys have done for us, and we'll never forget it. And it helps us in this time of difficulties. I want to read from God's Word, Lamentations 3, 17 through 24. God's Word says this, "My soul is deprived of peace. I have forgotten what happiness is. So I say, my endurance has perished. So has my hope from the Lord." And I'm sure this is how we're all feeling here today. It's really hard, and we're trying to wrap our heads around what happened, and it makes no sense. It's confusing. It's really, really, really hard, and it's really painful. We all lost someone here, a brother, a husband, a son, a father, a nephew, grandson, and a friend, and it hurts. Back to God's Word, verse 19. "Remember my affliction and my wanderings. My soul continuously remembers it, and it is bowed down within me. But," and this is what we all need, Adam's family, Paul's family, Sean, Kristen, Mom and Dad, and the rest of our family. And I say again, "But this I call to mind, and therefore I do have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. It's unfailing, and it is constant. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every single morning." In other words, with each day comes a new batch of God's compassion and his love and his grace for us as we walk through this difficult time. He sees our sufferings and draws near to those who are brokenhearted. And finally, God's Word continues to say, "Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him." Amen.
The following passage is from Romans 12, 9 through 21. "Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful what to do. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'It is mine to avenge. I will repay,' says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. And lastly, just as our fallen heroes have lived, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good.
Good morning. I'd like to get a response from everybody first. Good morning. Thank you. I'm going to read from the New Testament from John 15, 12 to 17. And it's only befitting because we have three unsung heroes with their names, of course, from the Bible. And we have one from John now. This is my commandment, that you will love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends. If you do what I command you, I do not call you servants anymore, because a servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, and that fruit will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in his name. I am giving you these commandments so that you may love one another. Thank you.
Practice crying so I wouldn't cry here. I don't know if that's going to work or not. Many is the time I felt mistaken and many times confused. Yes, and I've often felt forsaken and certainly misused. Oh, but I'm all right. I'm all right. I'm just weary to my bones. Still, you don't expect to be bright and bon vivant so far away from home, so far away from home. I don't know a soul who's not been battered. I don't have a friend who feels at ease. I don't know a dream that's not been shattered or driven to its knees. But it's all right, it's all right. For we've lived so well, so long. Still, when I think of the road we're traveling on, I wonder what's gone wrong. I can't help it. I wonder what's gone wrong. Well, these words, some of us are old enough to remember, were written by Paul Simon over 50 years ago in a particularly challenging time of our country's life. The words were descriptive then. I think they're prophetic because we feel some of those same things today. We're in a similar mood. And into this time, crises occur that take our breath away. One of those crises was just a week and a half ago in our city of Burnsville, Minnesota. I serve as a Burnsville chaplain for the police and fire departments. Sometimes people say, well, what does a chaplain do? My response these days is a chaplain spends some time with people in the worst moments of the worst days of their lives. And Sunday was one of those days for us, all of us. You know, I recall one call out just a few years ago. It was early in the morning. I went to the home, connected with the officer in charge and was given some basic information about the woman that I was to talk to. Her partner had died in his sleep. He had decided that he, several months earlier, he had decided that he would not use drugs anymore. And he didn't. Until he did. The night before. And he died. And the officer pointed to the porch and said, "She's out there. You can go talk to her now. She's expecting you." So I went and introduced myself and asked if we could talk. She could tell me what happened. She wanted to talk, but she was beside herself. She was chain smoking, and her hands were shaking with all of the stress that she felt. But she told me her story. And then it was quiet. We waited in silence. And all of a sudden, very loudly, she said, "Jesus Christ, why did this happen?" Silence again. And then just half a minute later, she said the same thing with the same intensity, the same volume. "Jesus Christ, why did this happen?" I asked her, "Do you know what it sounds like when you say that?" "No, what?" I said, "Well, it sounds like a prayer." "What?" I said, "Well, it sounds like a prayer. Would you like me to offer a prayer for you right now?" "Oh, yes. Yes, I would." So I waited, and then I prayed, "Jesus Christ, why did this happen? Jesus Christ, why did this happen?" I said, "Lord, even as we ask this, we know there are no answers that would satisfy. But honestly, it's a question in our minds and on our hearts. So we ask you, stay close. Give us even a glimmer of hope that we can make it through this. We so need you right now." Well, now she wasn't smoking anymore and her hands weren't shaking. We just sat quietly and talked for a while longer. You know, people of faith have always been familiar with hard questions, impossible questions. And God is familiar with people who ask impossible questions with whatever emotion we have when we ask them. The Old Testament prophet said, "How long must I call for help? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing?" That was Habakkuk. Job, we all know Job, suffering prophet, suffering leader. Job says, "Why have you made me your target, God?" And Job was the guy that had everything. And then he lost everything. And he kept his faith. Amazing. You know, Job was the oldest book in the Bible, first written. So these questions have been around for a long time. They've been around forever. Suffering has been around forever. Evil has been around forever. Grief and loss have been around forever. So Job speaks for all of us at one time or another. Sometimes it feels like we're a target. It's not fair. The New Testament disciples came upon a man who was born blind. And he, of course, was at a terrible disadvantage in life. They asked Jesus, why was this man born blind? I mean, was it his problem or his parents? Crazy question. The answer was, no, neither. No one's fault. It just happened. Jesus on the cross, as we know, quoted Psalm 22 when he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you abandoned me? Why have you left me all alone? We ask God the impossible question of why. But Jesus did, and we do too. We ask God that question. And even asking questions like that directly to God means on some level we believe he exists. And on some level we believe he's actually listening. On some level we believe he'll respond and somehow help us through. On a lighter note, I stopped by the Dairy Queen a while back. It was one of those middle afternoon, hadn't had lunch yet, feeling kind of low energy, kind of blah. So I stopped at the Dairy Queen. That always picks me up, you know. As I sat there pretending to read something and look busy, a young mother and her little boy walked by, and I heard her say as she walked in, "Today we can each get a Dilly or a Misty. Which would you like, Billy?" Billy blurted out, "I want a mudslide." And I thought, I like this kid. He had been watching television, of course. Well, his mom said, "Well, not today, Billy, but we can have a Dilly or a Misty. Which one would you like?" "I want a mudslide." So I put aside my reading. I thought, this is going to be much more interesting than whatever I was reading. The little guy said loudly, "I hate you." Well, now I was getting ready to call one of you guys to come because, you might need, child abuse going on or something. Mom didn't skip a beat, though. She didn't even change her expression. She just said, "Oh, that's too bad. I don't hate you. I love you. And I'd like to buy you a Dilly or a Misty, but since you're not interested in those two things, I guess we'll have to go." And she gently took his hand and started heading toward the door. All of a sudden, you hear him say, "Dilly." "Oh, would you like a Dilly? I think I'll have one too. Let's go order it." And off they went to the counter. Last I saw them a few minutes later, they were leaving, both eating their treats. He with ice cream running down his wrist. Still like that kid. Well, the point is this. God is at least as understanding as this wise young mom of this lucky young boy. He could say anything. And she said, "He's my son. I don't need to discipline him for thinking that he hates me. He'll learn. He'll grow. But he'll learn more if I'm kind to him, even when he's unkind to me." I believe that's the way God treats us. And in our grief, and in our sorrow, in our suffering, we can say anything to him and know that he will be there for us. He understands our thoughts, our deepest emotions and struggles and growing pains. God's love is far stronger than our reactions when we're in grief and suffering. So we ask him why, and we listen, and we reflect on it, and we talk with others who will listen to us, others who won't give us too much advice, and who won't tell us to see things differently, but will just understand what we're experiencing now. Not everyone understands grief or realizes the time it takes to get some relief. It's easy to become cynical. I'm an old English major, and Robert Frost was one of my favorite poets. He wrote this poem called Home Burial, where a husband and wife lost their infant son, and they're discussing their feelings and thoughts, and they're not getting along very well. So at one point, when the wife is leaving, she says, you know, friends make pretense of following you to the grave, but before one is in it, their minds are turned and making the best of their way back to life and living people and things they understand. We have thousands of people here today. Next week, there won't be thousands, but hopefully, we each have a few close friends who are there for us and will be there for us. And I can tell you the police and fire communities are very loyal to one another. They will be there for each of the families. I can promise you that. They will be there. A cynic is an idealist who doesn't want to be hurt again. When they've been hurt, they expect to be disappointed each time. Sometimes that's true, but in this case, it won't be. Our faith is a central resource for us as well. God doesn't leave us alone either. Listen to these interesting words from the book of Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. We aren't alone. We have each other. We have resources. We have the respect and gratitude of people in our community. And the prophet here lists three images of staying in the faith: flying like an eagle, running and staying strong, and walking without giving up. Now, paradoxically, the eagle is probably the easiest time. Rising up means spreading our wings and allowing the air currents to lift us up. And we're not fighting the wind, we're using the wind. That's why people who have a committed friend, they say, he or she was the wind beneath my wings. That's how I see a lot of the relationships in the police and fire communities, the deep friendships that are formed, the being there for each other, the respect, the crazy sense of humor, and the respect in the middle of it, the wind beneath our wings. So these friends make it possible for us to move ahead, make it progress, become successful, make it through difficult times of grief and struggle like these days. We need both our faith and our friends to lift us these days. Running is often difficult until you do it so regularly that you grow into it. And when you do, you can actually enjoy it. It's hard for non-runners to understand. I used to be a runner, you know, 20 pounds and 20 years ago. But you get to the place where you get this high, this runner's high. Again, if you're not a runner, don't even try to understand it. But if you are, you've been there, jogging along mile after mile. And there's a kind of sense of exhilaration that comes. I don't know if Isaiah was a runner or not, but he seemed to understand it. One would think walking would be the most natural and the easiest. Still, if you're exhausted and you don't have reserves of energy, Walking can become drudgery, and then it can even feel dangerous. We can question ourselves, wonder if we can make it, feel like there's never-ending corners to turn. Walking long enough can drain our energy, sap our strength, and lower our resolve. Grief can seem never-ending as well. It can go on for much longer than we hoped or expected. The promise is that we can make it through with the power of faith in the presence of one another. God bless us as we heal and grow and grieve and express ourselves to God and to our friends. As we do, we realize that we are not alone, that we can make it. We can slowly and surely grow into hope. May God help us to wait on Him and to renew our strength. They tell me there are a lot of people watching us today. I don't want to pass up this opportunity without suggesting that there may be a number of young people, high school, college age, young adults, who might ask themselves the question if they're called to these kinds of tasks, these kinds of positions. If you're someone of character, a young person looking for purpose in life, it's not because someone talks you into it. If you sense a calling to this, if you want to become people like we're celebrating today, think about it. Many, many departments, police and fire across our nation, are looking for the right people. You might be one of those. So I just invite you to consider it. Now let us pray together. Our Lord, the psalmist said that the Lord places the lonely in families. And yet three families are now lonely themselves because they each have lost a loved one. Paul, Matt, Adam. And they were lost unexpectedly, violently, unfairly. So now we pray for their families. Pray for their work families and police and fire. Pray for the broader community of neighbors and friends. Lord, you are our Father and God. You are the one who gives us courage and comfort, healing and love. We look to you to hold us up by your strong arms around us. We look to you with the psalmist to guide us with your eye. We look to you to open your ears to our cry. Give us faith to believe that you will be present with us in all of the challenges and changes of life. When we can't fathom what has happened and it doesn't seem real, be with us. When we are beside ourselves with rage at the unfairness of it all, be with us. When we are stuck in analyzing the situation, thinking that that somehow will help, be with us. When we are overcome with the heaviness of our loss, be with us. When we can't find anyone to trust enough to talk with, be with us. In all of these times, we ask that you bring your presence, and also people close who will simply be with us, a friend, not trying to fix the situation and certainly not trying to fix us. Someday in the future, will you lead us to a grateful place for the loving memories we have of Paul and Matt and Adam, for who they were, for the gifts that we have received from them, and for the gifts you want us to pay forward to others in their honor. Guide us in doing things that we're suited for and that would delight them to know that we were doing them while we were thinking of them. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. And now, please receive the benediction. Lord, lead us from this place, never forgetting, always learning from our memories of Paul, Matt, and Adam. May we live with courage greater than our fears. May we live with commitment greater than our self-interest. May we live with compassion greater than our pride. We pray in your name. Amen. Now the fire folks will come and continue their honors for these heroes.
When I am called to duty, God, wherever flames may rage, give me the strength to save a life, whatever be its age. Help me embrace a little child before it is too late, or save an older person from the horror of that fate. Enable me to be alert and hear the weakest shout. Quickly and efficiently to put the fire out. I want to fill my calling to give the best in me, to guard my friend and neighbor and protect his property. And if according to your will, I must answer death's call, bless me with your protecting hand, my family, one and all.
Everyone, please rise if you're able. The sounding of a bell is a tradition of the fire service and law enforcement. In the past, as firefighters began their tour of duty, the bell signaled the beginning of that day's shift. Throughout the day and night, each alarm was sounded by a bell, which summoned these brave men and women to fight fires and to place their lives on the line for the good of their fellow citizens. When the fire was out and the alarm had come to an end, it was the bell that signaled the completion of that call. When a firefighter had died in the line of duty, it was the toll of the bell that solemnly announced a comrade's passing. In law enforcement, the time-honored tradition of tolling a bell recognizes the officer's years of providing service and protection to their fellow citizen. It signifies the commitment of the officer to always answer the call to help their fellow man, move towards danger, and sacrifice one's life for another. And so, to Paul, Matthew, and Adam, who have selflessly given their lives for the good of their fellow man, their task completed, their duties well done, we will again sound their last alarm. They have gone home.
All uniform personnel, up, Dan. Huh. Freeze, Dan. On.
All units, stand by for final call. Empire to 45-183. Empire to 45-176. Empire to firefighter badge number 83. Empire calling 45-183, 45-176, and firefighter badge number 83. All units, Officer Matthew Ruge, batch 45-183, Officer Paul Elmstrand, batch 45-176, and firefighter Adam Finseth, badge number 83, have answered their final call. These men responded together, laid down their lives for one another, and died doing what they were called to do. The citizens of Burnsville will forever be in their debt. Their sacrifice will not be forgotten. Empire to 45-183, 45-176, firefighter 83, may you forever rest in peace.
You may be seated. This will conclude the insides part of the services. Your ushers will usher all the uniformed personnel out. If all civilians can remain seated, you will be released at the appropriate times. And with some urgency, if everybody can get out into the sea of uniforms out in front of door two, with the guidance of the ushers, we will get that concluded. Thank you.